work session for May 17, 2018 to order. At this time, we have a fairly full agenda. Got a fairly full agenda, so let's get started so we can get out of here. The first item on the agenda is department reports. Those have been sent to your electronic, you've had a chance to review the department report. Do any of the department heads have any input this time? Department reports?
I think they're available for questions if you have them, or hands that kind of conference and Kevin, if you have questions. Brian, if you have two minutes.
The only comment that I've got is I think that we ran into an issue with one of our committees not being able to reach a quorum a couple of times because of lack of attendance. So if you would please, I would appreciate if you would transmit to us and start keeping attendance and let us know what the attendance are for some of the committees. And if people can't make the meetings for whatever reason, they may need to replace them with other people willing to serve and aid us. So having said that, if anybody's interested in being on a committee, fill out an application before you leave. So, and we'll hold that in check. Any other information, comments on the department reports? Item number two is a variance request for internally lit signs. Todd, Joe Anderson, and Anderson PVC Hardware. It has come to light recently that we were preparing for a work session that it will be an involved process to have a variance for an internally lit sign. Having said that, there is a will from the council to review our light ordinance and put it up for discussion. And if you're agreeable at this time, we would like for you to come up to the podium and tell us about your variance request and what you're trying to do. If you're so inclined, please come up to the podium and just state your name, your address, and what blood type. and tell us why it is you're seeking us to revisit our sign ordinance.
I'm Jeffrey Anderson with Anderson Hardware. We're located on the bypass, but far enough off of the road where you can't see our business. So we've recently done a new sign, and we currently have a lit sign in the air, but we've got a monument sign now, and we would like to light it for not so much people knowing that we're open in it dark, because we're not open in dark, but we want people to know that we're there. We still have people, we've been there 15 years now, we have people who come in and say, I've lived here for 5-10 years and I had no idea you guys were here. So we're asking you this man for more exposure. I don't know if you've seen our sign, but it turned out pretty nice. It's not an eyesore, so that's kind of where we're at.
Is there any questions from the
council? Mr. Anderson, the sign that you are asking for a variance for, is it the steel sign or a different sign?
It's currently lit. It was lit before there was.
So
it could be lit.
So it's a sign for your business.
Oh yes.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes. Yeah. Sorry, I'm going to give the call. I'm sorry. The question was, can you repeat the question?
I had asked if the sign was the steel sign, S-T-I-H-L, which is a pioneer and it's orange, or is it a sign for your business? And Mr. Anderson said it's a sign for his business, so thank you.
It's a hardware. We're a do-it-best co-op hardware. That's No.
No.
And the steel sign's already lit, right? It's an internal lit sign. Because you guys were in the county before, and then annexation happened. And this kind of got wrapped into the city.
Yes. And we're actually, I think, we're a little over a half a mile outside the city limit. But so we're down the road a little bit from the city.
One of the issues that we're running into is that a variance request typically allows for whatever the variance is. And there's not an opportunity for a lit sign variance. At one time there was. The council could have an issue come before us and request for a lit sign. But at some point, I think in 2011, we redid our sign variances. And one of the things that we took out of it was an opportunity for a lit sign variance because they were being liberally allowed. Mm-hmm. And so I think the way the discussion went at the time was if we take out that variance, then we of course won't have any more lit signs. And at the time, that was objected by the council. In your situation, if we still have the variance opportunity, we still have that procedure where you could apply for a variance, you wouldn't be able to get one anyway. And the reason why is because you've already got the lit sign. So you would have to ask for a second variance. But having said that, there may be an opportunity to turn off one sign and variance the other sign if the council, you know, revisited our sign ordinance, which at the time is a very, very laboring task because it's all First Amendment related. And when we did it last time, we had literally 50 people from the public in pre-public hearings. It was a pretty big to do.
It was about a six-month process with consultants and advisors and all that else.
Now, having said that, I know the council is willing to revisit that sign ordinance. But it will be a process. It's not something we're going to be able to do tonight.
Right.
But on the bypass, there seems to be a significant amount of council that agrees that on the bypass in that area, it would make more sense to have a lit sign than our historic downtown. And one of the things that we're arguing against is all the billboards and LED lights and everything that Dahlonega historically has not been about. So it's an involved process.
We've been here. We don't want to do anything to take away from the historic part either. I've been here my whole life, so I'm not a big part of that. So, like I said, we're mainly wanting for exposure to the traffic.
Right.
If it comes by. So.
Don't we have something depending on that anyway? Don't you work out something? This is a work session, so we can talk about it. With the motel lights, weren't we working on something?
Yes, we don't have anything in place right now that lets us do anything about those hotel lights, and it needs to be addressed because they are far too bright and they are affecting what they call in a lot of communities dark skies. I know Greg is interested in this. And one of the beauties of Dahlonega is the night sky, and with not having a way to address those very, very bright lights other than by intriguing the motel owner, which hasn't been affected so far. We need to do something.
So in the future, we are going to make sure we're good.
Yeah, one of the things we are going to do is invite one of the experts on the dark skies from the university to come and present to the council.
We can address his concern at the same time. We don't let them fall on a black hole.
No pun intended.
Chip, are you willing to turn off the steel sign and kind of conform to what we do right now with the lighting of the do it sign on with the external lights?
So you're saying?
No, I'm just asking. I'm just asking, would you be willing to turn off one of the
it still be possible to externally light the steel sign, the spotlights?
Wait a minute, we're not saying that.
I know. I mean, that's hypothetical. That's allowable now, right, anyway?
Yeah, you can light externally lit spotlight any sign.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
There is a square footage limit. Have you looked at that? I mean, I don't know that you meet it or exceed it or anything. There's
as far as I know, we meet
that. You meet the square footage.
Because we submitted all that before we did that.
Okay.
Well, if we get the lid off of the sign ordinance, that's something that we need to think about, that there's already a lit sign there. There's some way to apples and apples without creating more lit signs. But what you were talking about with the dark skies, that's actually counter to, could be considered counter, opening up one end of the sign ordinances and restricting the other end. But anyway, it'll be before the council, and if they so desire, and when we can do it, we'd be opposed to revisiting our sign ordinance. But it'll have to be done in total. We might have picked up one element out, but it is all so interconnected. We'll just see what we can do about it at this point. But at first look, we thought we were in a position that we could offer some type of variance, especially if you were willing to go to this side and turn one on. But we don't have that mechanism as of now.
I think we just
that would have to be okay before we could.
Yeah, I don't really think that. Yeah, I'll go to jail.
I think there's a willingness we want to work with you guys. I mean, you guys are, you know, a hometown business, and it's important, I think, for you to have that exposure that you need. The reality is, the pace of government is kind of slow, and you got to chew the elephant eat the elephant one bite at a time. So if you just be patient with us, we'll try to work through all those details and get you out of it. Yeah.
Mr. Mayor, since this topic of lighting came up, when we did bring up the light pollution from the hotel company in town a couple of months ago, Bill, I know you and I talked with the owner about doing something voluntarily, but it doesn't appear that he's actually done anything to limit the problem. So I was wondering if you might be able to go back and ask him again to tone those down a little bit. I know he has a security issue there, but perhaps it's worth addressing again, because it's still pretty up there with his
I'll open another dialogue there, and I think I've got another run at it, and we may be successful this time. But before we create some more legislation, we go by and take a common sense approach. We're in a dialogue now, so maybe we can do that. Create ordinances. Thank y'all very much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank y'all.
Number three, input from Roberta Green Garrett, Hotel Mediation Hour. At this time, I would like to invite Mr. Joey Holman, attorney for Mr. Green, to come up and make an open presentation.
Thank you, Mayor. We appreciate the opportunity to be here. I'm here with Roger Boyd, and he will have any specific design or construction standards if y'all have any questions. Brief presentation I wish to make this evening is to let you know that this application, this certificate of appropriateness application was for demolition of the building and issue of Buffalo. This was filed on November 21st, 2016, and after we had gotten the COA with conditions from the council, the Parks building, that was initially filed in 2015. The plans, after a series of meetings, initially came forward in May of 2017. There were some revisions and resulted in the council decision on October 26th, 2017 that remains part of our discussion. And I just give you that brief background, historical background, because during that time, we have had the opportunity to meet with and go before the HPC on really three separate occasions. We had decisions. As a result of all that, Roger and I have had an opportunity to meet a lot of nice people. And we appreciated that opportunity, and we appreciated the feedback that we've received from the members of the council, the members of the committees that I've mentioned, and the public. And we've done our best, along with Ms. Green Garrett, to address the legitimate concerns that we heard being discussed. And outside of those meetings, we've had plenty of opportunity to meet with your staff on several occasions to go over the variety of issues that y'all have raised and that we have expressed a concern back from our clients about the feasibility of the project that's being proposed. We recognize that this is a very significant project for the city of Dahlonega, and it's also a significant project for Ms. Green Garrett. And we want to work together to try to resolve these circumstances and come to a win-win situation for the city as well as Ms. Green Garrett. As a result of that, Roger has most recently, and I know, let me just say, I know that y'all also have heard from a lot of people, and we appreciate the feedback that we have gotten from each council member. And I know the mayor sent around this to the different members of these committees that I've mentioned to make sure we had the input that we needed to try to move forward with that project that's been communicated to me from your council. As a result of that, Roger has gone back, and what you have now on the screen that's on the middle easel has the current rendering that we believe meets the feedback that we've received. The written conditions as well that Ms. Green Garrett proposes to satisfy the concerns that we've heard are on the, it's attached to that easel. They're also up here on the table, but if I can go through those, that we would agree in order to resolve this, the proposal we put forward are the conditions, which would be the use of the premises would be limited to a hotel. That would become a zoning condition. The hotel would have a typical mix, which would be consisting of a king room, double queen rooms, and 3 to 5 suites. From what information Roger was able to provide to me, the estimated square foot per room would be between 280 square feet and 340 square feet. The hotel shall have an exercise facility or workout room. It'll have a lobby area. It'll include a small outdoor pool with privacy fence and landscaping. It will contain meeting space. As we go forward with obtaining permits, the size of that meeting space and whether it will be available to outside groups will be determined by the parking requirements and what we can fit within the parking area. It will contain a breakfast lounge area. Will be operated pursuant to a franchise agreement with the National Hospitality Company. Usually these are between 10 and 20 years. She, Ms. Garrett, remains willing to cover the walkway as you see in the drawing. We've gotten into this issue a couple times. That's something the city would have to grant the easement or grant that request. But certainly if that's a benefit to the city, that proposal is what we suggest. Will have a brick exterior as it's shown. Parking will be on the property with a parking deck, and if the council deems appropriate, requiring that historical information about the city of Dahlonega be displayed, that will be done in the lobby area. That's an overview of where we see that, what we think addresses the concerns that we appreciate having been expressed to us. I'm going to let Mr. DuBois discuss the current rendering that's up on the screen. Thank you
all. The current rendering, what we have, as you can see on the screen here, we've got three different architectural styles on the front. You've got, if you start on the far left, you've got different headers, you have a different parapet design, and you have a different canopy. You go to the center, and you get a different style of brick format and different color. The center section, the same thing. You got a different header, different parapet, and you also have a different canopy. Also, which I failed to mention, each section has a different style window. What we're trying to do is to make it look like three separate individual buildings. And again, on the far right here, the same thing as the other two sections. You do have the end section, the two end sections are set back. It's kind of
see a little bit from the rendering there, set back about 2 feet. So it's not just a straight run on the front elevation of the hotel. We've got also to show and indicate that it's like three separate buildings. You really can't see it in this drawing here. If you go up to that drawing, you've got a door showing in each section, an entry door. And then, of course, your main entry door is a little bit bigger. We have carriage lights on each side of that as entry doors. And that's to bring the attraction to the entry point. And other than that, it's 76 to 77 rooms. It'll have a mix of doubles and kings. Has some suites. It'll have a meeting conference room in there. Right now, we're debating whether to put the conference room, which I like, on the first floor, on the first section there, and then the rest of the first floor will be your check-in area and your breakfast area. And then on the second and third floor, you'll have your guest rooms. And of course, they'll continue in the back above the parking deck. Any questions?
How big is the conference room?
Pardon me?
How big would a conference room be?
It'd be a minimum of at least 18 by 24.
Okay. Have you figured out how many people, theater size, that would hold those dimensions?
Well, right now, we'd like to do comfortably have at least 20 to 24 in that size, but it depends. I mean, if I went to 20, let's say I went 24 to 26 deep, and let's say I was 18 foot wide, you know, I could probably get 20 to 24 in there comfortably around a conference table. Or you can have basically, you know, stadium like seating or chair set for the little meeting and presentation. That has not been decided, but we do know the importance of having a meeting room for this facility. We think there's a demand for that, and that's going to attract a lot of business travelers that come in this area. Also, it's going to be a big attraction for weddings and so forth, if they want to have a room where they can get together.
The mention of the small outdoor pool, privacy fence, where would that go to?
The pool will be behind the far right section right here. What you have is you've got right now the Butler building is about 82 foot deep. Property line was about 84 feet. The depth of this wing right here with guest rooms will be 20 to 22 plus 20 to 22, so it'll be around 50 feet in the total depth. So you have that remaining area. It will not be a large pool, it'll be a small pool.
Does the parking deck go flush against the back?
The parking deck basically, as you go to the end section here, it goes, it will step down, and it goes to the parallel street behind.
I noticed the room count was at 77-ish. But you haven't done working drawings because this is the first run at the conceptual.
Correct.
And you've got to get across that hurdle before you can do a working drawing. But as of right now, you're looking at roughly 77 rooms. That would require 77 parking places.
Correct.
And then all of those are self-contained.
We'll be able to accommodate guest parking, whatever room count we come up to, in the parking deck. We will use probably the space behind the adjacent building that Ms. Garrett owns for employees and stuff like that. There's enough space back there to put 25 cars, or 20 to 22 cars.
You're talking behind.
Behind the antique mall, it's not being used right now. All they have there is a dumpster. What we would do is we do angle parking. Angle parking is a little bit less than depth. Typical parking space, 9 by 18. So what we do is do angle parking on both sides where they drive in and then pull back out.
I have one more question about your meeting room. Are you talking about just one meeting room that will only hold 24 people?
Yeah, and that hasn't been decided yet. What we have to do now, if we get through the approval process, what we'll do is we'll sit down, we'll do a footprint and do the study of what we actually can do. We don't want to take too much out of the breakfast area, the gathering area, and the reception, the check-in area, and whatever we can fit into that. Because what you have on that far left side, on that first level, basically behind that is a parking deck. So we can maybe approach into that area and make it larger, but it's too early for me to commit to an exact dimension or how many. We want to get as many as we can.
Good. I know you already know this because you had mentioned it, but that does bring in weekday business, and I think that's going to be very important.
One thing that take some, get some photos and some things to tell us the history of the line. We think that's extremely important. And that feature point will be in that conference room, to really tell the history of the city of Dahlonega. And we'll do that, we'll repeat that, and repetitive type photos, depending on which ones are selected, throughout the guest rooms also.
Ms. Harper, let me just tell you too, that we have the parking requirements change once we open that up to outside users of hotel guests. So part of what Roger's got to worry through is if we have a concept approved, then we have to see, because we're already going to be pushed on parking some, how much parking we have available to meet the requirements of the ordinance. But we recognize that once we come up with it, we would have to comply with the ordinance as to that use. So that's just something we've got to work through as we go forward.
Before we, 1 second, Mr. Taylor, I'm gonna try to direct traffic as much as I can. You got a follow up? Just let me know, Mr. Taylor.
I just have a question. If you could clarify the height of the building relative to the Chamber of Commerce, is it the same as the earlier rendering?
Yes, same thing. Well, you got a gamble roof on the Chamber of Commerce. And if you take that far right rendering there, you'll see we're going to be a little over 30 feet, maybe 30 feet 6 inches, 30 feet 8 inches to the roof deck. But as Bill will point out to you, you got to have an average on all four sides and not exceed the requirement. And the requirement here is governed by the height of the Gold Museum building, and we will comply with that. That will be confirmed once we get into the design. We'll submit that to the city, let them do their calculations, and go forward.
Thank you.
I just wanted to confirm, since we've been working on this together for a couple of years now, you guys should be pretty familiar with our existing ordinances and codes and so forth. Is it your intention to abide by the existing ordinances and codes so that we would not expect any further variance requests as you go through the process?
Yes.
Thank you.
Go on down there.
I think y'all come to realize that we've dug our heels in pretty hard on some of these things, and that's the reason there's a mound on this table here, and 3 years have expired. So I think it's wise to try to pull the variance request. Good question. Yes.
Roger, the headers on the center section and the left section, what material would those headers be made out of? Is that
well, what we got is we're using a cementitious precast type. You're talking about header, the long header?
Yeah, I guess that's what you call that.
It's not a fly star on the fence.
It's not stucco or anything. Even on the left side, it would not be stucco. And that's on the left side, if you had windows, that would go all the way down. Was that Meadow Street?
Right. Every header is precast. It's a custom preformed deal. Basically, you'll have a color difference in shape of the headers. So you can see this is a dark, then you go to a little bit light and then a lighter down there. All three different,
Whatever you do on that left side, you'll have to continue that down Meadow Street, correct?
Yeah, we'll continue down.
Okay,
yeah.
And I guess I'm assuming this structure would include a central heating and air system.
Well, what we have, the ordinance requires that on the front, you have no through wall units on the front on Main Street. So what we have on the first floor, the second floor, third floor, there'll be no intake air vents whatsoever on the front on Main Street.
Bill, you're taking good notes. I guess we get accordance too, but Roman had a very good point that the facade that's on the front of the far left building, that treatment facade will continue down there as well.
Trying to clarify, because there is going to be an open air area for the parking deck. You've got to have that for exchange of air.
Right.
And they're wanting to put some false windows on the backside and stuff. And we'll work with people. And we'll work with you on that. I mean, what we'll do is, you don't have a rendering of that. As we get into the design, I'll give a bill. We'll bring it out here in the city. And we'll look at it and see what's best for the city. That's not a big issue. One time, they wanted us to put false grids with no glass. Where that open area is, where the parking deck is, but we can't enclose it because we've got to have that air. I mean, that's a life safety issue. So.
Now, I'm not a builder, or anything like that, and I don't claim to be on TV or anything like that either. But It seems like the left side of the windows, it looks like it's set in a little bit, correct?
Yeah, the two in section, this section, the right section and the end section are both 2 foot in from the center section.
Yeah. Well, no, I'm not talking about the building setback. I'm talking about the window treatments on the left. It looks like it's set, the windows themselves are set in maybe a brick level or so.
What's given that's not an illusion because of the size and the depth of the header.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay.
So see, the header itself is a little bit larger.
Okay.
It's a different design. But they're all going to be set in at the same elevation. It's just a little bit different because of your header.
Yeah, okay.
So you've got a deeper header down here than you do in the center, and you even got a different configuration of head here.
But it looks like on the left that it looks like there's a brick square, a ledge around it, around the window.
That's a sill, a brick sill?
Yeah, maybe I need to show you on
the right here. This right up here, there's a brick sill here above the actual canopy?
Yeah. That's on both floors, it looks like.
It's on both floors, but it's not on the center section.
Right. Yeah, I'm just talking about the left section.
It's an architectural feature of the brick, basically.
Looks like the brick's popped out and it's in a recess over that segment.
Just to give you a different look.
Yeah. I didn't know if it'd be looking, the center section looks kind of flush, but it's not really set back as far as the window treatment. So I don't know if it would be easier to put that on the left, but that's up to you.
We're just trying to get that appearance of three different times.
Right.
Mr. Holmes, this is probably a question for you. The hotel shall be operated pursuant to a franchise agreement with the National Hospitality Company.
Yes.
Explain that to me. Is that public yet, or?
No. Well, and it's what we've run into is that having the particular hospitality group come in, they don't want to come in until we're approved, so we're in a chicken and egg situation. But we understood that there was a concern expressed to council and some in the public that this would be approved and then it wouldn't be operated as a hotel. So in conferring with our client, we have agreed to this and we've agreed it would be a standard hospitality agreement that would run 10 to 20 years.
So we jump through all the news and we approve this. You still have to wait until somebody comes forward to do the franchise, right?
Right. Roger's been helping and some.
We're in the process right now. Once we have finalized that, then Joey and Sean can bring it to you guys and actually show you the ring. That it will be a national flag, is what it'll be.
I wonder if it would be worthwhile explaining that this is a legal binding document by the court. So our challenge that we're facing is, do we agree and mediate for something that we have some input into, or do we run the risk of whatever the judge may decide down the road? So that's kind of the basic dilemma facing the city now that there's been a suit against the city. So I think this is a very challenging decision to be made because we've got to either put our thumbprint on this design along with Roberta Green Garrett, or roll the dice and see what the judge may say.
Maybe the mayor and city attorney can tell us what the next step is.
Yeah. I think you articulated quite well is that if this is a relatively informal mediation, not the type of the true type of legal mediation that would come next in your litigation process. But during this time period, you have an opportunity, if you wish, to follow something of this course and negotiate and come to a conclusion that is finite, one that you can see what actually occur, or alternatively, we can continue the litigation process. And that will, that probably will not be resolved for another year or so, or maybe a little longer. And in that, we, it's completely indeterminate at this point, but undeterminable at this point, as to what that result might be. So that's your decision to be made. Is do you want to negotiate and come to some agreement as to some structure, or do you want to allow the litigation process to continue?
I appreciate the fact that we've been at an impasse for the last several years, and the mayor, the city attorney, the city manager got together with the property owner and her team, and we finally come up with something.
And if you do, as Ms. Taylor definitely said, is that it would be a consent order which would be binding and enforceable. It would be enforceable by contempt should there be a deviation from any of the.
So in layman terms, the judge will look at this, and both parties, us, if we're agreeable, and the judge can just say, okay, go do it. It's out of the court, and we get it.
It's out of the court, but then the court retains jurisdiction of it for enforcement.
Okay.
Or enforcement, whatever the terms might be, should there be a agreement between the applicant and the city.
Right.
I think it's important that everybody know that process and know where we got where we are. It is also very important to the council for us to take this highly unusual step and open up our mediation, albeit self-imposed mediation, to the public. It's highly unusual. I mean, councils and governments have hearings all the time, but to include the public for input into a mediation process that eventually could end up in a binding court order is highly unusual. And having said that, I would entertain that if anyone in the audience would like to approach the podium and have some input, now's a good time to do that. I'm going to limit it for about 3 minutes, and we will take some input, and we're also trying to record what people are saying as far as if there's ideas that we've overlooked or if there's concerns that are important, now would be a good time to come up and take advantage to come up and speak. But when you come up, please come to the podium and state your name and your address, and then you have 3 minutes to say anything that's not insulting. And if you would, please address the council. I think it's important that we retain a decorum and a businesslike attitude here and not be personal. So please address your comments to the council at this time. And if the attorney or architect or Ms. Garrett needs to speak, he'll be glad to, I'm sure. But please come forward if someone did.
Okay.
Concrete at one time. The other, of course, has the old slats on.
buildings that are being demolished, that would be demolished if this goes through. And I have a problem with that. I appreciate the fact that the sidewalks are going to be covered similar to the way that they are now. That's awesome. It's sad that we're going to lose retail space, that it will just be a hotel. There'll be no retail. All of that is being groomed. Of course, it's been gone now for quite some time as the buildings are being left to rot. In my mind, we have to have standards. And we need to have standards that we're willing to set high. I taught school for years, and I pushed my students. And I got an award one year because I was the pushiest teacher at the high school. I made my students look at the top. This is where you need to be. This is where we're going. This is where I'm pushing you to go. And to me, this building speaks of nothing but mediocrity. This is not upholding historic standards for this community. And once this is there, it's going to be there for 100 years. That whole block now becomes this big brick blob. I appreciate that they tried to differentiate, but they didn't do a very good job. Sorry. They did not do a very good job in my mind. They could have done something a little different to at least make the one building look like three completely different buildings, as opposed to we're just going to kind of change the color of the brick a tad. I hate to see that our city council may be capitulating to mediocrity. I would appreciate if we could look at the higher standards and say, okay, you're going to have a hotel here. Can we not have something that doesn't look like a commercial franchise hotel, which is exactly what it looks like? Thank you.
I'm Ben Smith. I've lived here on and off for about 8 years, going to school here at UNG. And first off, I'd really like to say that y'all have done a good job standing up for the Historic Preservation Commission's deliberation, I'd say. Like, it was a mistake. I would admit the city council's decision to allow the parks building to be demolished, pending on the certificate of appropriateness. I'd say that was a mistake. But there was redemption with the decision to deny certificate of appropriateness to demolish the Butler building. The whole issue here is not what the hotel looks like. I think it's a nice looking hotel. And so the whole issue here is the place. This is not a place for a hotel. This is a place for two historic buildings to remain here and be preserved. So I appreciate the city council and the HPC working together, and I can only hope that they stand their ground and try to go with what the HPC says to their arguments to keep these buildings preserved for future generations, because the tourism in this community is all dependent on historical architecture, I would argue that. And I think that some of you could agree with me. That's where the revenues come from. That's the attractor to this city, because it's so unique. And you can't make a unique building, especially when it's not built in the vernacular like that. You just can't do that at all these days. So I wanted to thank you for standing your ground.
Is not what Dahlonega is about.
We all know what Dahlonega is about, and I don't want to spend 3 minutes repeating what has been said hundreds of times about our rather unique little town. And I think unique is the important word. We are unique. We have a unique way of living here. We have a uniqueness downtown. That is mundane blah. Now, if you want to build it, go over where there's that flat property over there by Chick-fil-A, between Chick-fil-A and Walmart. If you want to build that thing, put it over there. That'll attract the tourists who want to come here and stay at that. But that's not what Dahlonega is about. We all know what Dahlonega is about. I don't need to repeat it. And I hope that y'all will somehow, I know she sued the city, y'all, everybody else, probably hopefully people who don't speak up here, stand up for Dahlonega. Stand up for what we are and who we are. And I think we all know what Dahlonega is about.
Quaintness of our town and beauty. Now, sure, there's other buildings made of brick, but they're small footprints of one single building. This is a monstrosity. It's made to look as three, but it's basically one big blob. This is the biggest building in Dahlonega. Our town is not that big, it's small. Is this what we want to be known for? This takes up so much room. And another concern I have is, Mr. Boy said they're going to be parking for employees behind the that antique place we have. Well, will that not affect the public parking spaces next to it? I know there's not that many there, but they're going to have to take a few of them out. And you know, that's, we need to keep the line up beautiful, not.
I'm over time right there this minute. But stay where you're at. But no, the on-street parking can't be affected by that, is my understanding.
Well, how will they get into that side building then?
Well, there's an entrance there now. So, I mean, I'm not going to every point discuss, but yeah, that parking can't be touched. And,
okay.
And therein lies the question that Ron asked. If you're asking for more variances and they can't, or aren't willing to ask for more variances, and all their parking will be self-contained, is what we understand and what we're going to require.
And then,
that's your question.
Then they're saying that they have a parking deck in back and a little pool there. That's not very attractive either. This whole thing is just, you know, doesn't add to the charm of our town at all. Thank you.
Diane Mays, that was my husband, Lamar.
for the 128 Pearl Bar. I'm representing Reserve Historic Dahlonega tonight. And even though, another point, even though we live in Lumpkin, this building will impact this whole county, not just Dahlonega. And that's why I thought it was important that Lumpkinites should speak out too. I have a couple questions, and I know I was very proud when the city council said no, you can't demolish the Butler building because of its historical significance. And remember, that's why we got where we are, is because the city council said no, because it had historical significance. Those stones or cement or blocks or whatever were deemed historic. I don't see any place in this design where we have, where we're making use of those historic blocks and middle parts. Also, when the city agreed to tear down the Parks building, one of the things was that you would use, that's part of the city code, that you'd use some of the pieces and parts somewhere in construction. This has no part of the two buildings that we're destroying. You have to remember our codes, the guidelines, demolition guidelines. Those are in there. And as we go through this, we've got to make the, if we agree to have this, we've got to make people, the developers, remember that. Another key thing is, I didn't see where they check in. The front doors are in the beginning. Are they going to be checking in at the front? What about those parking spaces? Maybe that's addressed somewhere. I didn't see that. One other issue is the franchise is key. If we go ahead and approve this and say, all right, let's have this, it's going to be a franchise. Is it going to be a red roof? Is it going to be a sleep-in? Is it going to be happening? That is key, folks, when you are building and giving someone permission to have a franchise in your downtown. Remember all these things. Thank you.
My name is Chris Merritt. I'm one of the founding partners of the group on activism in Dahlonega. I just wanted to say a few things about. So, Roberta Green has a reputation in this town. I actually was going to rent from her rent for food here until she tried to charge me over $1,000 for like a two-bedroom apartment. Ridiculous. Luckily, I found a landlord that actually rents for $800. Amazing guy. I'm late every month. But, like I said, I am a struggling college student. And I came to Dahlonega because it's a small town. It's a beautiful town. I got to know a lot of the members, and I'm so happy to be here. When I found out this was being built, I felt visibly sick. Like, it doesn't belong here in Dahlonega. Dahlonega is known for the small town atmosphere, for walking around and knowing you're going to go to a small business and, you know, say hey to someone you saw last week or something. But this is bringing in corporate America to the small town feel. It's breaking a tradition. And you're talking about the business center and stuff. There's plenty of room in this town for a business center. I mean, it's going to be in a hotel with Roberta Green buildings. I mean, it's ridiculous. I don't know if I'm the only one here that feels that way. And if I am, that's fine. But let's not do this. Let's at least preserve some part of the lawn. But this building isn't doing it. Thank you.
Mayor Norton, State Council, Parks, Mr. Hoonis. As you work towards resolving whatever it is that you're going to resolve, you spoke briefly a moment ago about Councilman Larson holding accountable to ordinances and codes and plans. I think it would be well, I mean, you spoke to Parks about contempt orders if we wind up in Superior Court having to enforce an order. I think it would be wise for all parties to agree and look at a very significant liquidated damage penalty should the developer fall below the minimum standard that is given and presented and agreed on eventually, if anything is reached and agreed upon. In addition to that significant penalty, I think that it would be wise to consider a pretty significant continuing penalty per day to penalize any non-compliance that might somehow throw the town into outrage. What that does is relieve the Superior Court from having to hear expert testimony, from having to, the burden of the city from having to reduce it, to show what that damage is or may be, because it's very hard to throw a hotel in jail, right? That is impossible. So what you want to do is protect the community's interest, and it seems to me that money speaks very loudly. Thank you.
91 miners around in Dahlonega. And my father was a developer up in New Jersey and had a great architect. And I'll tell you what, this is not a good looking building. It has no, you know, this is gonna be one building off the square, and that is an awful lot of brick that, you know, really needs some personality, and I just don't think that the architects are trying very hard.
Hi, my name is Jerry Piper. I'm 27 Alta Vista. And I agree with the gentleman, this building would be great at the end zone, part of the addition to the community. But I can understand Roberta's trying to make something profitable out of property that she owns. What it needs is some kind of signage that would make it look more amicable to what Dahlonega is about. And also, you have 77 rooms here, 280 square feet. We've all driven through the highways and seen 30 and 40 year old motels abandoned. So what is this going to morph into in 20 or 30 years with 280 square foot rooms? We all know it's going to be dormitories. So why doesn't the architect take that ground floor and create some retail space, which would take away from the 77 rooms, but it would also be a steady monthly income for Roberta? Because she would be renting out 7 or 8 new additional stores, which would increase the amount of retail space, and she would still be profitable with maybe 55 rooms built around that area, and with some better signage and a few modifications, we'd be a nice building. Just an idea.
So a little bit of history about how we got here is Ms. Garrett purchased the property on July 15th, 2015 from Norman Adams and Tony Anderson for a sum of about $650,000. She pretty much immediately applied for a certificate of appropriateness to demolish the Parks building around August of 2015. The HBC in October 2015 voted not to allow the demolition, and that matter was appealed by the applicant to City Council. And as you know, we overturned that decision with some conditions, and one of those conditions included the applicant must have an approved design by HBC before the building could be removed. Around July 2016, the property owner requested variances for planning and parking. That was one of the times that Mr. Holmes came before us, and we ultimately denied those variances at that point in time. In July of 2017, the city proposed an alternative design. Some of you may have seen that posted on social with the property owner to see if there was kind of a stalemate. So we hired an architect, the city hired an architect to come up with a rendering of what that might look like if it incorporated the Butler building and it was less rooms and included retail and some of the things that have been mentioned. That was ultimately rejected or not accepted by the property owner. The property owner then applied to demolish the Butler building. So HPC ruled not to allow that certificate of appropriateness, and the applicant then again appealed to the city council and the matter, and in that decision, the council upheld the ruling of the HPC not to tear down the Butler building. The applicant then filed a suit in Superior Court regarding that decision only, the decision to tear down the Butler building. She still had permission to tear down the Parks building, assuming there was a design approved by HPC, which it seems to be the hang-up is the design for a lot of people. So she filed suit in Superior Court. That means pretty much kind of what Mr. Parks was talking about. She has filed suit against us. It hasn't went before a judge yet, but at any point in that time, we can sit down with the property owner and try to come to an agreement. So in January of 2018, we got a new mayor and two new council members, or council women, I should say, on our council. And at our February retreat in 2018, just a few months ago, it was a top priority of council that we resolve this issue. And because we don't want this to drag on any longer than any of you do, and certainly Ms. Garrett doesn't want it to drag on any longer than she would like to. So at the urging of council, the mayor and city attorney met with the property owner and her representatives to begin a discussion and dialogue. And during that meeting, the mayor laid out some facts for her, which I think it's safe to say we kind of, all the things that you guys have addressed, we laid out to her, and that's kind of why you have this list for Mr. Holmes of the things that we said, hey, it has to be this, it has to be a hotel, it can't become a dorm, it can't become student housing, it can't become a lot of these things. During one of those meetings, actually the mayor and council member Taylor met with Ms. Garrett and her representatives on a separate occasion as a follow-up meeting to that meeting. And during one of these meetings, and there was actually a third meeting too, that the mayor met with just the representatives, Mr. Holmans, and I believe Roger, you were at that meeting as well, and so it was. And at one of these meetings, I want y'all to know what the council, and this is really for the benefit of the public, the council's kind of, or me personally, I'll say this, I agree with some of the comments that have been said. I agree about the location. And I think it was, the council kind of sees some of that too. We, in fact, offered Ms. Garrett a land swap to build her hotel in another place. And then we would assume ownership of these properties, and she rejected that offer. She wants to build her hotel on that location. I think that's important for y'all to know. So that brings us where we are today. And that brings us to the opportunity to allow you guys to have input. This is not, as Mayor Norton said at the beginning of this is not typical or normal. So we do value your input that you have. The reality is, Ms. Garrett purchased a property almost 3 years ago for $650,000. And that building has not, she's not earned one penny on that investment. And that's a challenge for her, and it's a challenge for us. We have two buildings in downtown that are basically vacant. And so that's not good for a downtown either. So there's a lot of challenges to this situation, but that's how we got to where we are. And that's why, we do value your input, and we do appreciate everything that you've said and everything that everyone has said here today, because we do value that, and we will take that into consideration.
Very good. It's pretty accurate rundown. Does anyone have anything different to say?
I
do. No, you're right there. Yeah, this one, Paul.
Mr. Warner, who is an adjacent property owner, probably has more to say relevant to this conversation.
conversation with most of the people in this room.
Probably. Most likely. My name is Preston Warner. We own Parkplace Hotel, which is right directly behind said proposed property. I have dealt with squandering squatters for a number of years that still to this day live above the Butler building. Everything over in that corner is disgusting. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. It's a gross area. It's an eyesore. My guests, we moved our office from the back of our building to the front side because of the parking lot being vacant, not being maintained, and just the night walkers and people coming in and out doing dope. So I would like to see something done with the property, yes. I think it should be an income-producing property. Yes, I do. Do I think a 75-room hotel is a good idea in that area? No. I think a hotel is a great idea. I do agree with some of the people about the retail space. I think that's a great idea to have downstairs. The small meeting room of 25 people, that does nothing for anybody. We have 75 rooms times two people or four people per room. You're talking 100-something people, and you have a room that basically takes up two rows of these seats. I think that's a waste. I think that's a joke. As far as aesthetics, I can see where they're trying to be more of a modern, forward-thinking building while trying to keep some of the older ideas from the historic downtown, but I think it's got a little too much in it. But, you know, again, I think something needs to be done, but I think 77, I think, is too big. I think that parking deck is going to be quite large, and I'm sure that it's going to be right on top of my building and on my property line, probably. The pool, if I'm not mistaken, is the pool going to be in between the parking deck and the building?
Pardon me?
Listen.
Would the pool be in between the hotel and the parking deck?
Yeah, it'll be there. Hey, your building just comes up to the back of the other building property. To be in that general area there and then off to the side.
Okay, so if you took the stairway in between the two buildings, between the Parks building and the Butler building, the dilapidated stairway?
Yeah, I know.
If that went straight back to the parking lot, so the pool would be like in that grassy area?
Yeah, it'd be somewhere. We haven't done a final design, but in that general location, yeah.
Okay. On what level?
Pardon me?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I mean, I'm for her doing something with it because I'm tired of having, you know, the police come over next door. I'm tired of hearing my guests complain about it. As far as rooms, does anybody know what she's going to try to charge for these rooms?
We haven't at that point.
Okay. And the franchisee part, is that an independent franchisee or that's a national? So that's a Marriott, that's a something of that sort?
Yes.
Say it again.
All right. That does what I stand.
Very good. Thank you for that. Okay. All right. Thank you all for participating. Thank you all for taking out your schedule and being a part of the process.